This mission moment is designed as kind of a fact-finding mission. We had the privilege just a handful of weeks ago to commission Grace and Monica to a trip to Uganda. And not everybody here knows that or knows who you are. So Grace and Monica, for those who are new to our midst, and I've got a series of questions I know you're prepped for, but we want to hear from you about your trip. I'm going to mic you up so that you're ready to go. So first of all, for those present today who don't know specifically where you've been recently, let us know. Where were you and what did you do?
So Mrs. Antotman and I spent a week at an orphanage in Uganda called the Gem Foundation for Kids with Special Needs. It's located in Kampala, and we were there just to play with the kids, love them, and help the nannies and serve them whenever we could.
How about the journey? I think that's always a curious thing to ask about. How did the plane ride work? How many stops were there? Where did you travel on your way down the plane?
So it was fairly uneventful, which is good, probably. But we flew to Amsterdam. And then from Amsterdam, we had a stop in Kigali, and then we landed in Entebbe. And on the way back, we just flew from Entebbe to Amsterdam, and then Minneapolis.
How about, give us a little bit more detail about the Gem Foundation, maybe a day in the life, if there's such a thing, at the Gem Foundation. What's a typical day look like?
So given the variety of special needs and the unpredictability of some of the more medically fragile little ones, 2 days are never exactly alike, but they try to retain a sense of normalcy and permanency for their kids and their nannies. So each nanny has 2 or 3 kids that are her kids, and she takes care of them, she gets them up, she dresses them, she feeds them and plays with them. So she'll get them up in the morning and feed them, and 4 of the older kids go to a nearby school, and then they hire a teacher to come and teach the rest of the older kids. And the nannies teach the younger kids their alphabet and stuff. And each afternoon they have a nap, and the nannies do the laundry, and there's lots of laundry, because each kid goes through several pairs of clothes, and right now their washing machine is broken. So all the nannies have these huge piles of laundry to wash in the afternoon. So while we were there, we helped with the laundry, we played with the kids, we painted, we did everything we could to help them serve.
I might just say about the laundry, there were probably 4 long, long clotheslines that they hung the clothes out on, and then they laid all the diapers on and the bibs on the ground. So eventually they all got dry.
So one of the neat things about this trip, for many of you who are aware, we had an opportunity to participate as a congregation in this, and there were both some needs and some wants there at the Gem Foundation. So we're curious, were you able to bring everything? Did it go off without a hitch? Were you able to get these things in the hands of
into a suitcase. Yes. If you smush it down. But we were able to bring everything, and they were very grateful. Emma and Josh, the founders, felt very blessed by all the people who want to help and bless the Gems, and just the people are thinking about them and the Gem Foundation. And the nannies were just overwhelmed that they had new kids and new toys and new clothes to give their kids. One of the nannies, on the day that we gave all the clothes and toys up, she was standing in the room that her girls stayed in. And she was just laughing with tears in her eyes because it looked like a little girl's room. And there was a rug and there were blankets and there were new toys and new clothes and baby dolls for her little girls and bows for their hair. And she was just so glad that they got to experience that and have the experience of being a little girl and having toys and a pretty room.
We also brought a ton of sheets that people provided, and we were able to fit each of 40 cribs with a new sheet. And then we got a good financial donation from the church as well. So pretty much mom-free and relatives and friends bought 40 blankets. And the kids just loved them, the nannies loved them. And one little boy kept escaping from his crib and running down the hall, but he always took his blanket with him.
Excellent. So I've heard hints here and there that you had an opportunity to be a part of a worship gathering, at least one. Is that right? So maybe compare and contrast for us a little bit. They worship the same Savior, believe the same Bible, but what was similar about worship? What was totally different about the way that they approach corporate worship? Tell us about that.
Mrs. Totman and I went to 2 different churches because she was visiting with one of her friends in Uganda. But the biggest difference for me is that when we walked in, they were singing, and everybody was dancing, and everybody was completely into it, just jumping up and down and spinning and waving their arms and just singing. It's it's not something that you normally see here. Hundreds of people dancing to the music, but I think the dancing was the biggest difference for me. And the missionary that lives there said that's normal. Where there's music, there's dancing, and everybody dances. So we got to dance.
Can I tell a story about you? So that night, we got to our room and we're comparing our church services, and the first part was the same. But then the one thing we wished for was that there would have been a little more God-centered preaching. And Grace told me that during the service, she had the idea of counting during prayer how many references there were to I, me, and our. And what did you come up with? Was it like 70?
57.
57 or something like that? So anyway, it was a lot of me-centered, and we were thankful for Pastor Dave as we talked about it and wished for more pastors in Uganda that would go God-centered.
Well, maybe just I'll rip on that for a minute regarding being scripture centered. Scripture says in Ecclesiastes 3:4, there's a time to dance. Okay. Time to dance. Also commands us to lift our hands in worship, so it's okay to be expressive, as Scandinavian as we are. Okay. So, okay. All right, how about just one of the most beautiful memories that you have, maybe of one of the gems, or just a moment that you're going to carry with you, you suspect, into the days ahead? Tell us about that.
For me, the most impactful thing wasn't necessarily just one moment or situation, but the joy that was all over the gem foundation and the gems, because by our standards, they have so little, but they chose joy. And the first day we walked in, and the first thing we heard was the laughter of the kids in the next room. That was the norm there. They were happy. They were giggling and smiling and very happy. And that joy just influenced everyone around them.
I would agree with that. And then also a special opportunity we had was to go to a piece of land outside the city of Kampala where the air is clean and not smoggy for many of these children with respiratory problems. And the GEM Foundation was able to purchase 88 acres and it's paid for. And they're raising money to start building. And the thing that impressed me was Grace intentionally is following a dream that she has. And I believe God wants to give each of us a dream of something that he wants to do just through us. And then to do it. And Emma, the founder of the GEM Foundation, when she was younger than Grace, had a dream. And for 5.5 years, only 5.5 years, she has made this happen in Uganda. And God has opened doors for her incredibly. And they now have 40 orphans and over 50 staff. And now they have 88 acres of land. And the company or the mission organization that's going to build the buildings said, we're going to push you up on the schedule and start building yet this year as soon as they get the approvals because the momentum is there. They already have buildings for money, $350,000 for individual homes for a group of the gems. They don't all live together. One home is $100,000, so they can do three already and then enough for half. And it's just amazing, the dream. And we saw it before any of that has happened. But I think that was exciting, and someday we're going to see it completed, I believe. And I'm just so thankful for Grace's dream and for Emma's dream, and that God will keep giving us dreams here. And I know he has, and he will continue.
I'll ask you to hang on to the mic, because I've got one more for you, Monica. So you have a history of global missions. You've had the privilege to live in Japan and Singapore, you've done missions work in India. What was it about this trip to Africa, to Uganda, that was unique and unlike anything that you've seen in your travels?
Well, I would just start that by saying, first of all, God gave us a special needs child, and he lived for 8 months. And so that was the beginning of my heart, but you know, only 8 months, and then life goes back to normal. So it was short. Then, when I was in India, we took a side trip to Mother Teresa's ministry home. And one thing Mother Teresa said that prepared me for this trip, people asked her, how did you decide to do social work? And she said, this is not social work. This is the loving power of God. And I saw that in Uganda, even in a greater way because of the length of time we were there. And I just know when we had our babies in John, we were struck by the verses when the religious leaders came to Jesus and said, "Who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" And Jesus said, "No, no one sinned. It was that the works of God would be made manifest." And each of us has an opportunity to do that, no matter what our abilities or limitations are. And I was so struck. And I thought, you know, I've been a little bit in awe of the leaders of the Christian world, the theologians, the Bible people that we all love and admire. And when we get to heaven, I can just see a long line waiting to talk to David, to talk to Abraham. And I thought, I hope when I sit at that long marriage table at the supper of the Lamb, maybe I'll get to sit across from one of these gems, or maybe I'll get to sit across from that man who was born blind, and Jesus healed him. And it doesn't matter how great our scope of influence, just that we're faithful. And that just blew me away.
That's powerful. Thank you, Monica. And then maybe same question to you. So this was your first mission trip, right? So tell us about what this maybe looks like for you, how this impacts you in the days ahead, and particularly as you think about discerning the call that God has on your life.
I've known that I want to work with orphans, particularly special needs orphans, for a long time. So it was very special for me to go and to see people doing that, what I want to do. And I think it was helpful for me to see all the different ways that people help and care for these kids, because it's not just the doctors or the nurses or the founders, the nannies who dress and feed the kids each day, and the people who come and help with the laundry. And it was helpful for me to see that and all the different ways that people are caring for these kids and what's involved in caring for them day to day. And I think it helped me envision how I can best use my gifts to serve the orphan and what that would look like for me. And that's something I can pray about and work towards in the day ahead.
Sharing. We appreciate you taking time to do this and giving us the update. I think we had some pictures, but of course we're having some projector issues. It sounds like we maybe will use some pictures in Fellowship Hall later after the worship gathering, so that stay around for that. Take a look at those. So thank you. How about I hand you those to the drivers?